Good evening and welcome to a special edition of Remarkable Essence. I'm Don Causey, your host, and I'm so glad you decided to tune in with us tonight. We are going to have a great show in store for you. We have some fabulous guests, which you know we always do, but we have some informative topics that we're going to be talking about tonight. This month is actually awareness of sexual violence and domestic violence and sex trafficking. There's a lot of things going on in that area. So I decided to go ahead and get some special guests to focus on that this evening so that we could be more aware about what's going on in our communities and how that affects our communities. Believe it or not, you have like 1 in 4 girls or 1 in 4 boys that are actually sexually molested before the age of 10 or 12. That is a great statistic, and so we need to put a stop to that. And we need to promote civility. Do you know what that even means? Well, we're going to talk about that tonight, too, because we have our special guest that's going to be here, and she specializes in that area. I would like to give a shout-out to our product sponsor for the Remarkable Essence of a Woman Health, Wellness, and Empowerment Conference, Rishi Tea. And tonight we're going to be sipping on our tea as we go throughout the episode, having fun as well as, like I said, we're just going to get our party on. You see, I put on my red dress. For those that you can't see me, I'm looking fly, don't worry. But yeah, I wanted to go ahead and celebrate. It's 1 year that Remarkable Essence has been on the air. And again, I applaud you all and I thank you for your support. Without you, the show couldn't go on. So tonight we're going to have first Dr. Betty Mitchell. Dr. Betty Mitchell has been in corporate America. She was actually a vice president of a Fortune 500 company, and she's also a ministerial counselor. She's been in the ministry for a number of years, but she's also a specialist and wants to hurt people that are hurting in certain areas of sexual violence and molestation and just depression, and the list goes on of her qualities. She's also a single parent, but she's able to strive because she puts God first in her life. We're going to go ahead and we're going to take a look at this video, and we're going to get, like I said, we're going to get our party on today. So this is Jill Scott, and hate on me.
Silver platter, would it even matter? You'd still be mad at me if I could find in all these a dozen roses, which I would give to you. You'd still be miserable. In reality, I'm gonna be who I be.
Go!
Welcome back. That was Hate on Me by Jill Scott. Isn't she awesome? I love Jill Scott.
I love her. My son loves her as well.
Really? Mm-hmm. Oh, well, shout out to Dr. Betty's son. Thank you so much for coming on the show tonight.
Thanks so much for inviting me.
You are welcome.
It's an honor to be here.
I am so glad we were able to connect. And like I said, Dr. Betty is a phenomenal woman. I mean, her bio, I couldn't even get into it, but you guys are going to learn a little bit about her tonight, definitely, and about her ministry and, and you know, what you have to offer to those that are in the Atlanta area.
Yes.
So let's start off with your corporate. You were in corporate America.
Yes.
And then you transitioned to ministry.
Right.
So tell us about that. I mean, how did you go from corporate to ministry?
I will. As a matter of fact, I taught school 10 years before I ever got to corporate.
Are you serious?
Yeah, so I was there for 35 years, so I know I'm telling my age,
oh,
right?
Oh, wow.
At any rate, I started in a corporate out in Oakland, California.
Okay.
I was working as a teacher out there at the time, mm-hmm. and one of my best friends, my husband's best friend, mm-hmm. ex-husband now.
Oh, okay.
Xerox wanted to bring some people in, and they were looking, this is kind of unusual now, but they were looking for minorities that they wanted to put through a special program.
Oh, wow.
And I was one of those chosen, and was really blessed to go to work for Xerox Corporation.
So you went from teaching to work for Xerox.
Into a major corporation.
Wow.
A
and
Fortune
so what did,
500
So what did you teach?
I taught English.
Okay.
And as speech therapy.
Okay.
And I ended my school career in Oakland as an audiometrist. I was the first black female to receive a lifetime certificate in audiometry.
Wow, that's awesome.
That was awesome.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
I'm honored to have you on the show.
I'm honored to be here.
It's always something new that you learn about people because, like I said, you try to read up on them and then it's like, what are the little nuggets that you never know about? So that's pretty neat. So you worked for Xerox. Mm-hmm. How long were you with them?
I was with Xerox 25 years.
Okay.
I said 35 earlier, but it actually was 25 years.
All right.
And I retired from there as a vice president of Southeast, which included Atlanta, which is why I got here, mm-hmm. Puerto Rico, and South Florida.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. I would love to go to Puerto Rico.
Oh, yes.
Let me be the VP over there.
The waters are beautiful.
Oh,
there.
I know, I know. I've been there to Isabella.
Okay.
So that's beautiful over there. So yeah, so you were with Xerox, and then I know while you were there, you were called to ministry.
Well, actually, yes, you're absolutely right. I remember getting transferred from California out in Irvine at the time back to Fort Lauderdale. Miami is, Georgia is really where I was born.
Oh,
but,
okay.
I was raised in Miami, Florida, and I remember after going through a divorce, I had two children, mm-hmm. and my ex-husband had gone to Southern California. I was still in Northern California,
okay.
and really felt that I wanted my children to be around their grandparents,
mm-hmm.
and so for that reason, we decided to transfer, and I saw just along the pathway of my life, mm-hmm. I've really seen divine moves, if you will,
mm-hmm.
because no one had ever gotten transferred back to their home location.
Wow.
And so I got transferred back, and I was there for from 85 until I retired.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Wow. So ministry.
Ministry. And when I got back to my divine pathway,
mm-hmm.
but when I got back to Fort Lauderdale, that's when I... though I had been brought up in the church all of my life,
mm-hmm.
when I got back to Fort Lauderdale, I had a hunger. It was a different level of hunger and thirst to really know God in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you what happened. My sister went to church. I remember my sister and I went to a club.
Mm-hmm.
And we were both sitting there saying, you know, this just isn't us anymore. You know, it was empty. It was
mm-hmm.
very void
mm-hmm.
and was not fulfilling. And so shortly thereafter, she went to a church service while I was home and got filled with what we call the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
That's a speaking in tongues kind of thing. I guess it's okay
mm-hmm.
to say that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, the Bible talks about a godly jealousy,
mm-hmm.
not jealousy in terms of envy where you
yes.
want something or want something bad for someone.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted that so much in my
mm-hmm.
life. So I met this good-looking guy, right, who... was filled with the Holy Spirit, and he, our daughters, put us together. Mm-hmm. And so he invited me over for dinner one night, and of course he fixed this dinner, and he cut up the steak, and he fed me our very first night, right?
Oh, wow.
But so
went all out.
Yeah, he went all out, right. So, but he also was filled with the Holy Spirit, so in mm-hmm. order to kind of capture him, mm-hmm. I decided to pray and ask God to fill me.
Wow.
I got filled. Didn't get the man, but I got the Holy Spirit. Well, I got the man.
They got the man. That's right.
The man.
That's wonderful.
Absolutely.
That's wonderful.
But he was very encouraging, and that was a great friendship.
So along your journey, mm-hmm. you start focusing on domestic violence. And so how did you kind of meander down that path?
Well, it really started with sexual abuse. Mm-hmm. I was sexually abused as a little girl around the age of 5, but I didn't know it. Mm-hmm. And it's very typical that sometimes when you're that young and you don't know how to process abuse, you suppress it. Mm-hmm. And so it's really interesting how the Lord revealed to me that I'd been sexually abused. But what actually happened, the church where I went, my pastor, though I did a lot of traveling, I remember coming in one day from a trip, mm-hmm. and she says, I'm going to put you over this department. So that's kind of how it started. It was a women's department. Mm-hmm. And so she never gave me any training in terms of what to do. So I just decided that what we needed to do was pray. If we didn't do anything else, mm-hmm. we could pray, right? Yeah. And so I had the women come in. We would do shut-ins on a Friday night mm-hmm. and on Saturday. So one Saturday, I was talking to a group of women, and it turns out that one of the ladies there, son, had been murdered. And she was appearing to be okay, because there's something that we call kenosis, where you start to empty out things that are hindering you and hurting you and affecting your life and keeping you from moving into the pathways that God has for you. And so she was pretending to be okay, and hiding the guilt and the shame that she was experiencing, because normally she didn't let her son out. I'm going to get to your question. Normally she didn't let her son out, and this particular someone knocked on the door, and he answered the door and stepped out. And when he stepped out, mm-hmm. he was shot dead right there mm-hmm. in at the house. And she was burying that in her soul. Mm-hmm. And so that was the first time I saw God really start to move in mm-hmm. deliverance in my life. Mm-hmm. And the next one was a young lady that same morning who confided in me for some reason that she had been sexually abused by her grandfather. Wow. And she had gotten married and was trying to have a baby, and she could not get impregnated.
Wow.
And she felt that the hindrance was because every time her mind, in the act, she couldn't relax mm-hmm. because those pictures, mm-hmm. Oftentimes you hear people who have been sexually abused talk about the smell. Mm. They can go all the way back to the wow. smell, the perfume, the soaps, mm-hmm. and the smell on the clothing, and those kinds of things. And so that particular day, for some reason, we just prayed with her. Mm-hmm. She went down under the anointing, and about 6 weeks later, she was pregnant.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Right. Jeez. And so that's how, and she was the first one to confide in me. Mm-hmm. And then other people, it's really interesting how when you have a special anointing for something, whatever it might be, mm-hmm. It draws people, that
that's
energy,
true.
Whatever that is, will draw those people
that is
to
so
you.
True.
So people started coming up to me talking about sharing their stories with me mm-hmm. about sexual abuse. Keep in mind now, I still didn't know mm-hmm. that I had been sexually abused by my uncle,
wow.
who used to hem me up in the back of the room, mm-hmm. A little dark room at our home. And, of course, thank God he didn't penetrate, mm-hmm. but he fingered. Mm-hmm. And I always had this feeling of shame with my husband when I was married. I always wanted to make love in the dark.
Yeah.
It's just this kind of show.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's fine.
The kind of thing.
Oh, yeah.
Wanted
yes.
to, and I was, it was a shame-based mm-hmm. kind of mm-hmm. a spirit, mm-hmm. but I didn't know where it was coming from. Because mm-hmm. he loved my body. I mean, yes. he was attracted to
oh, yeah.
my body.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but I didn't
you
feel
didn't.
Good about my body. Right, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And so, it was as a result of that, those meetings with the ladies and the prayer and them coming forth is how I actually got started in this ministry.
Wow.
It would be 7 years later before when I'm up ministering and doing an altar call for people who have been sexually abused. And all of a sudden, I watch Wall Street with the little sticker every day.
Mm-hmm.
And so I see, I'm talking to them and telling them to come forth while in my mind that little ticker is showing me in the back room with my uncle and what he was doing. I saw that, I articulated it to the group. Well, my mom was sitting there and I had one sister sitting there and they had never heard this before, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I said a family member, I didn't say who.
Mm-hmm.
And so that created a real stir because I had an older sister who was out in the vestibule waiting to come in. And when I said that, obviously she thought I was alluding to my dad.
Mm.
And we had some conversation about that. But it was through that revelation that I then realized that I had been abused and it had gone on. Now, had my dad known that, he probably would have killed my uncle.
At
that time.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah, you don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
But I started to realize where the shame-based feelings came from, and it came from that. Because one of the effects, and I write it in my book, I do a workbook in the back of the book because we look at the various effects of sexual abuse, and guilt and shame and blame are three of those effects, in addition to so many others.
Yeah, so we're going to talk a little bit more about her book, but her book is Inner Healing for Holes in the Soul, right?
Yes.
And we're going to take a quick break, so let's take a look at this video, and we'll be right back.
I'll tell you something. If you pay the price, you can get what you want. I can get it for you.
Really?
Now, if you want something really young, that $200, it just costs a little more than that.
Sure.
How young are you talking? Talk to me.
Well, how young do you have?
Well, I don't have nothing younger than 14.
Okay, no, 14 is good.
Okay.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Well, you're going to have to add something to that.
Sure.
What you willing to add to that, too? Just talk to me.
Well, like I said, this is my first time out. So the girls over there cost two, is it?
That's the women.
The women.
Now, if I told you two, and you know you want something younger, I tell you just to add something to it, just tell me, you just pick a figure to that.
Well, I guess, three?
Three. If you do three, you got it.
Definitely just beat us, like it'll probably stump you out, like stump you, like when you're on the ground, physically stump you. Yeah. He'll probably hit you with a belt, physically slap you, punch you.
He would beat me with broomsticks, candles. He would burn me with candles. He would take metal hangers and beat me with them and poke me with them, belts, anything that he can get his hands on, he would beat me with. The one time he had beat me so bad that he had ruptured my spleen and it put me in. So it's like once you knew that he could almost kill you, you'd rather do what he says than to get beat again.
If you come to them, that'll be like 150.
Okay.
If they come to you out call, that'll be like 200.
Okay. And I got a hotel room, so that's an out call.
Yeah, that's
okay, so 200 each.
Yeah, an hour.
Okay, so I'll give you $400. Do I give them $200 or I give it to you?
Me, right.
Okay,
now.
So I'll give you $400 and and then I can get, we can tip the girls whatever on top of that.
Yeah, okay, that's about
it. Is that all right with you?
Hello, I run all this.
Okay.
These are my girls.
Oh, okay.
They don't do nothing but look pretty and
we're all under 18.
Wow, isn't that something?
very sad. Still breaks my heart.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So definitely this is something that is ongoing within our community. Mm-hmm. And I know that, like you said, you wrote the book, mm-hmm. Inner Healing for Holes in the Soul, mm-hmm. based on your experience. So let's talk a little bit about the book, mm-hmm. and what inspired you to write the book.
What inspired me to write the book is that I started studying about the soul. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about our soul, we're talking about our mind, our will, and our emotions. It's, mm-hmm. it consists of three parts. Mm-hmm. And I had so many people with whom I had worked, mm-hmm. In the ministry who had come to me about sexual abuse, and I had actually started doing a ministry around that. I saw twin sisters, or sisters rather, they weren't twins, who had come to the altar who were as big as this table. And they wanted to be big like that because their brother, their dad and their brothers were sexually abusing them. And so I had heard so many of those stories and saw the devastation, but I also saw people get healed and delivered, mm-hmm. as a result of ministry. Mm-hmm. And so I felt that if I wrote the book, what I did in the book was made sure that I used people's stories, mm-hmm. who had gone through it and had come from a victim to a survivor.
Yes.
And I wanted them to share with the world,
yes.
how they were able to get through that,
yes.
so that they would be able to help someone else. Mm-hmm. And I also saw the devastating effects of like the anger, mm-hmm. and the guilt and the shame. And when mothers would deny that they knew any, that mothers would say, oh, yeah. I didn't know. Mm-hmm. And of course they would, that's a double whammy, if you will, mm-hmm. for a daughter,
yes.
or even a son.
Yes.
So I saw the devastating effects and wanted to do a workbook, mm-hmm. so that in the privacy of their home, mm-hmm. because it's so shame-based, mm-hmm. a lot of people don't talk about it.
Of course.
And we know that, and we see marriages now, 50% of marriages, first-time marriages end in divorce, mm-hmm. 60% of second-time marriages, and 70% of third-time marriages.
Wow.
So if our marriage rate is so high, what we don't, there has to be something more, mm-hmm. than, because you fall in love,
yes.
and then you're not able to make that work, mm-hmm. even a second or third time around.
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes it's because of what's going on inside of the
mm-hmm.
soul that people need to deal with.
Yes.
And that's where all of those offenses, the effects are lodged, mm-hmm. in the soul realm. And if you don't get somebody to help you understand that,
mm-hmm.
you will go on perpetuating,
yes.
that kind of devastating lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things I found is that as a result of sexual abuse, a lot of my clients and the people with whom I ministered to were taking a different kind of pathway. Those sisters took a pathway of eating,
mm-hmm.
because they didn't want to be attractive and they didn't want to be with a man.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this will take a pathway of homosexuality.
Mm-hmm.
We believe that about 90% of people who've been sexually abused,
mm-hmm.
will take, particularly women, will take a pathway of lesbianism.
Yes.
And so you find all of those kinds of things. And so the book was designed to give them a workbook that they can use in the privacy of their home,
mm-hmm.
if they're in a jail cell, wherever they may be, at their own pace, at their own time, but they can deal with the anger, they can deal with the bitterness, and they
mm-hmm.
can walk back through. Now, I tell people who are buying the book,
mm-hmm.
to the degree that it becomes too painful,
mm-hmm.
for you to work through it, stop.
Mm-hmm.
Call me,
okay.
or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to give them something, a tool that they could work with.
And if they want to order the book, mm-hmm. here's what it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
Where would they go to order the book?
You may come to my website, which is www.healingoftheheartsministries.org, or through Author House, Amazon,
okay.
and what's that other, Barnes & Noble.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then you, we also have joining us Miss Loretta Reed, and she's a specialist in civility. And so you
mm-hmm.
talked about people behaving the right way,
yes.
how things can change and alter because of what they've gone through,
mm-hmm.
As a child.
Mm-hmm.
And we're seeing a lot of that nowadays, right, Loretta, to where people
mm-hmm.
are not being respectful. And
mm-hmm.
so to promote civility, what does that mean? I mean, what do people need to do to promote civility?
And it really becomes about awareness. And I think one of the main things that I try to do as an ambassador of goodwill, if you will, is really just help people to start the conversation again. Somewhere along the line in our society, we dropped that conversation. Mm. We dropped the training, teaching people how to behave in public life, mm-hmm. because that civility is all about. How do we respect one another? Mm-hmm. How do we honor each other's humanity? Mm-hmm. Of course we're going to disagree, but we can mm-hmm. disagree without being disagreeable, yeah. and yeah. expressing that,
yes.
In a bad way.
Yes.
So I call it my prescriptives of civility: respect, responsibility, and thoughtful response. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes today we are reacting, overreacting. Mm-hmm. We don't think about it. Yeah. We just act.
Yes.
But when we stop and we think about how does that affect my fellow man, mm-hmm. it brings another perspective to that.
Mm-hmm.
So looking into these people that are doing this mm-hmm. human trafficking, or mm-hmm. even somebody that builds up to a place where they mm-hmm. feel they have to lash out mm-hmm. at their loved one, you know, mm-hmm. domestic violence, and we hear about that all the time. Mm-hmm. Is it something that could have stemmed from childhood? Is it because of the lack of civility, of them not knowing how to act? I mean,
and I think yeah. a big part of that is, you know, there's a saying that hurting people hurt people.
Mm-hmm.
And you often, you know, repeat what you've seen demonstrated to you. And mm-hmm. then those hurts, as Dr. Betty talks about, the holes in the soul,
mm-hmm.
when those holes aren't filled with something positive, mm-hmm. with something that's going to really help them grow and develop positively,
mm-hmm.
when you still have that emptiness there, again, people react,
mm-hmm.
you know, and sometimes that's reacting in violence,
yep.
you know, abuse against other people.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just a vicious cycle.
Yes.
And
yes.
until we start to do things to have more resources mm-hmm. and more tools so we can have the conversation and
yes.
direct people down a pathway of healing, it will continue.
Yes.
And I know that even us as a community here mm-hmm. in Atlanta,
mm-hmm.
we're trying to come more together and bring more awareness. So that's why I definitely wanted to have this topic on the show. But
mm-hmm.
I saw a few months back to where they have a system to where truck drivers, I don't know if they have a code or something like that, but to where they can report if they see some type of human trafficking
yes.
activity.
Mm-hmm.
And then they can report it. They could be anonymous,
mm-hmm.
but they do have those mm-hmm. in place as well.
And that's what we have to start doing
yes.
today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of my favorite radio hosts talks about, you know, he brings awareness to different conversations. And as people
mm-hmm.
call in and they report the problem and talk about how the issues are so bad,
mm-hmm.
his final question is always, now what are you going to do about
mm-hmm.
it? And that's a perfect example of that,
mm-hmm.
where these truck drivers say, you know,
mm-hmm.
well, I can do something.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we all have to stop and think. When we see people behaving badly,
mm-hmm.
then we've got to demonstrate good behavior. And sometimes we really have to step in and say,
mm-hmm.
hold up.
Yeah. And I think sometimes, too, people may think even they're crossing the line. Like if you hear a person getting beat up and they live next door and
mm-hmm.
you hear that all the time,
mm-hmm.
I mean, somebody has to be the one to call 911 and say, like you
exactly.
said, enough is enough. But I think people have gotten to a place to where, well, that's your business or that's
mm-hmm.
their business, and or I don't want to get involved because I don't want to get caught up in, you know, I think, I don't know if that's being more selfish because you don't report it, or
I think it's just apathy. You know, people have gotten very
mm-hmm.
apathetic about
mm-hmm.
a lot of
mm-hmm.
things, but we have to really think about this as a social disease.
Mm-hmm.
And when you think about things, that diseases that become epidemics,
mm-hmm.
then, you know, there are people who start to think about what's the solution
mm-hmm.
yes.
to this problem.
Mm-hmm.
How can we begin to develop medicines that can help address the disease?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so that's what we have to do in terms of civility or incivility,
mm-hmm.
if you will. That is the new social disease.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to start the conversations first. And then we can, out of the conversations will come
mm-hmm.
ideas about how we can implement it back into our school civility training.
Mm-hmm.
It's basic manners.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You know, there was
mm-hmm.
a time when we learned these
That's
things
right.
at home.
Oh, yes.
It was reinforced in schools.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But when you take that out, focus on one part of us, mm-hmm. you know, then you lose.
That's what you're going to get.
That's what you're going to get. Mm-hmm. So we are a product mm-hmm. of what has happened in our society.
You're right. You're
so,
right.
you know, that has become my mission mm-hmm. is just to be mm-hmm. that voice to raise awareness.
Yes.
And one by one, as we all begin to do that and chime in to raise our voices
yes.
and we begin to mm-hmm. sing the song of civility,
yes. mm-hmm.
then I believe then we'll begin to change our world.
Definitely, mm-hmm. definitely. And a few years, it's probably been about 5 years ago, I started a program for young people called mm-hmm. Dance Etiquette, and it was mm-hmm. dance
oh,
plus etiquette.
I love that.
I taught them how to set the table as mm-hmm. if they were going to dine at a five-star mm-hmm. restaurant. We taught them conversational skills, mm-hmm. how to shake, you know, look at someone in the eye, shake your hand,
yes.
introduce yourself,
yes.
Modeling. So, mm-hmm. because, you know, remember the song Pants on the Ground?
Oh,
remember
yes,
that came out?
Yes. How can
I was
we
like,
forget
well, my
the pants on the ground?
I was like, well, my children are not going to be walking around with the pants on the ground.
Okay.
So I said, something mm-hmm. needs to be implemented.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of, like you said, that's kind of model behavior. Mm-hmm. We used to have charm classes, right?
Exactly.
When we were growing up. Or they even have debutantes. But they're still far and in between. I don't hear a whole lot about those like
mm-hmm.
we did, you know, back in the day, so mm-hmm. to speak. So,
exactly.
So we do need to have more of those type of programs because our children nowadays are influenced by the media,
mm-hmm.
of course, social media,
mm-hmm.
videos, the music.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
and right. a lot of times the parents are just... they're working
mm-hmm.
and they take them to school and then they come home, they cook.
Right.
And it's like you said, you don't have that sit down time,
right.
that time to say, this is how you should act
mm-hmm.
or this is how you should not act.
Exactly.
Like I have a son now. And of course, talking about civility, you know, him being 13, when he grows up, I have to say, son,
mm-hmm.
when you get pulled over by a cop,
yeah.
you know, do I need to teach him? Don't reach for anything. You
yes.
put your hands on the steering wheel and
mm-hmm.
you just sit there and you say, yes, sir, or whatever. So the cop can ask whatever, and you don't move unless he tells you to move.
I mean, exactly.
That's, it seems like that's the place that we're getting to,
mm-hmm.
that there is even a certain way
mm-hmm.
that civility is going to need to be taught,
right.
even within the African-American community.
It is. Well, and actually, mm-hmm. it's all mm-hmm. segments of our society,
mm-hmm.
because from mm-hmm. the White House, you know,
mm-hmm.
to our living rooms,
mm-hmm.
you know, back to the meals at home.
Mm-hmm.
When you think about the number of families that actually sit around a dinner table and have a meal together, that conversation that takes place during that time, that's teaching the child
mm-hmm.
how to engage
that's right.
another person.
That's right.
And when you miss out on that and it's going through a drive-thru
mm-hmm.
and shoving the food down your throat, I mean, it,
that's it.
You know.
You're not teaching it.
Mm-hmm.
You're right. Yeah, and it totally gets lost.
It does.
Mm-hmm. It does. And so how did you become an advocate? I mean, what? Because you're so passionate
mm-hmm.
about civility, and it's a rarity that you have someone that says, I'm passionate about teaching people etiquette,
right.
and I'm going to get out here, and I'm going to just make sure, like you said, to shout it from the rooftops.
Yes.
We need other people to catch that same
mm-hmm.
fire,
yes.
right?
Absolutely.
So how do, I mean, what
and
inspired you?
And we go back
you
to
and
our
how
childhood.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it was something that was very important. I had, and I call it a blessing, that I had the opportunity to be in a household, one household where, you know, people, you know, maybe talk loud in the way that they responded to each other
mm-hmm.
and, you know, did not sit down at a table and,
mm-hmm.
you know, the food's there, go
mm-hmm.
get it.
Mm-hmm.
But then on the other hand, with my godparents, whom, you know, I lived with for a great part of my childhood,
mm-hmm.
almost up until the time I went to high school, they were very passionate about making sure that they engaged each other in their marriage. And just watching the way
mm-hmm.
that my uncle treated my aunt
mm-hmm.
and, you know, the way that the care that she took to make sure that we sat down and had a meal together, we had conversations,
mm-hmm.
we talked about current issues,
mm-hmm. yes.
we did homework together, but then we also did things like what you said,
mm-hmm.
I went to a Sears charm school.
Mm-hmm.
So those helped open doors for me in my life
yes.
that, you know, had I only remained
mm-hmm.
in the other setting,
mm-hmm.
that would have been my learned
that's
behavior.
Right. That's what you know.
So because I could compare the difference,
mm-hmm.
You know, obviously, you would rather have this as opposed to that. And so, you know, even with my own children who are adults now, you know, I just repeated what I had learned. You know, so I raised civil children, you know, and those who, you know, had that social education. And so I just care about it. And I think that caring began at an early age, because I can remember thinking, this is the kind of life that I want.
Definitely. And so you all have a conference coming up, actually this weekend. And tell us about that.
Well, we are really excited about the conference. The theme is healing deep wounds. And the different, it's not a scar, it's not a tear, a wound goes deep. And so one of the things that we realized is that people are hurting in our families, in our churches, in the store, on the street. We're seeing a lot of rage, we're seeing a lot of anger, we're seeing a lot of killing, and we're seeing families being torn apart as well. Moms and daughters not interacting with each other, and siblings not getting along. And what we wanted to do was to have a conference that could bring to celebrate the sexual assault month and deal with that, as well as domestic violence, human trafficking. But we also wanted to bring in, like, pastors' wives. We have two ex-first ladies who are coming in to share their stories, because I don't think we know how much is going on with pastors and their wives and the divorces and the relationships that are going on with members within the church. And so we wanted to be able them share their stories and allow the anointing on their life from that to reach out and deal with people sitting in the audience so that they can be set free. And so we have that, and we have somebody dealing with, and of course, civility. This is very unusual to have a civility talk of this type conference. But when I look at civility in terms of the wounds that we have, I think we have to come to a place where we understand that even the wounds have a purpose, and we can look at that wound as something that is going to hinder us from going forth and stop us where we are and keep us unhealthy and in hate and bitterness and anger. Or we can say, okay, there's a purpose for this, you know, and if I can understand how I can take that and use it to my good, then everybody is going to be better as a result of that. So we wanted Deaconess Loretta to focus on, how do I bring civility into my wound? Because if I can do that, that means I'm going to, if you wound me emotionally, I'm going to forgive you, because forgiveness is something that we are required to do for us. It's not for the other person.
That's true. That is true. And the thing is, you brought up a great point that people need to be able to do that for themselves.
For themselves.
Because a lot of times, going back to hurt people, that's what they do.
That's what they do.
And so the your RR, I said, what is it? Double RT.
That's you remember?
I remember.
Good for you.
The double RT. You have to walk around and be mindful of that. And, you know, if you're in the line at Walmart and the person's taking, like, Walmart's my thing, right? I think that's where God teaches me how to be patient, because I'm like, doing up there, or maybe and it could be, you know, they have to do a check, or the person, the cashier maybe just a little slow, or the person is slow, but I'm just like, I believe that's just my pace, my place of patience. But you have to be mindful, and the thing is, you have to sometimes reflect on, why would you lash out, or why are you stressed, right? And you have those different stressors, and that's kind of how our society is as a whole. It's like, you know, you want things fast, you want things now, and not necessarily do you need it at that moment. It's like sometimes you need to step back and reflect and take your time, and then put yourself in that person's shoes.
There you go.
And a lot of times, a lot of times we don't do that.
Exactly.
And that's what we need to teach our youth, is that, wait a minute, even with the bullying and all of this, and that's what they have to do to kind of reach to their peers, right, is to say, well, this is how it affected me.
Right.
And that's when they can identify with that, then it's like, oh, so it's like, oh, would you want that to happen to you?
Right.
You know, the same thing with, you know, the domestic violence or even the human trafficking
right.
piece. And the thing is, you know, prayer. I believe in the power of prayer.
Oh, absolutely.
But I believe we are in the last days as well. So it already tells us a lot of this, these things are going to happen. We live in a sinful world. So we just got to do what we can. That doesn't mean we live in a hopeless world.
No. And there we go.
But
there we go.
So that's the difference.
Our hope isn't
but you got a lot of hopeless people.
Yes.
So it's our job to communicate hopefully that to them and hopefully they'll turn their lives around. And it's never, you never go through the process of the journey for you.
Right.
But like you said, it's always for someone else. Somebody else.
And that's what we want to share, hope,
yes.
at the conference. We have a young lady who's going to be talking about domestic violence. And one of the things, one of the revelations that I got recently meaning within the last 2 years on domestic violence is the impact that it has on children who live in that environment. And studies, or at least one study or several studies have shown that, I think I shared this with you, that the impact on a child who lives consistently in a domestic violence situation has PTSD at a greater level than a soldier coming back from the Vietnam. They compared the soldiers who came back from the Vietnam War. And so we don't think about the fact that when I'm hitting my, you know, mate upside the head, that's having a negative impact emotionally, mentally, physically on the child.
Yes.
And I find in my practice that when a couple comes in and the husband is beating the wife, 9 times out of 10, he watched his father or his mom's boyfriend beat her and wanted to do something about it, but it may have been too young, but said in his heart, I'll never grow up and do that. And that's exactly what they grow up into, because behavior is learned behavior. Yeah, it's we do, like you said, what you saw your grandparents
Godparents
do, that's what you did, and that's what you taught your children. So what we learn is what we do, and so we have to change the way we look at things, and that's what this conference is about. It's about healing, it's about deliverance, it's about giving them a new perspective, giving them hope that they can have a better life, and they don't have to stay trapped in the past.
Wonderful. And so if they want to go register or hear more about the conference, for more information, where can they go?
Well, you can go to my website. Once again, it's healingoftheheartministries.org. Or you may go to Eventbrite and look for Healing Deep Wounds Conference at the Georgia International Convention Center on Saturday, April 18th, starting at 8 a.m. to 5.
Wonderful.
And that the registration is like $45, but it includes the lunch and parking.
And they will feed you, because they brought me some small cupcakes. I'm so excited. Today, I was debating on if we were going to eat these cupcakes with our tea, but I think we're just going to stick with our tea, because we're looking too cute. We don't want to get any frosting on us, right? And so, so Loretta, get information about you and your agency, where can they go?
My website is www.bondevoir.com.
Okay.
Bon devoir means good duty. A duty is a responsibility, but I feel like this is a good duty for society. So we're the good duty company.
Definitely. And if there were etiquette classes as well, offer those services
as well.
Anything else that we should know as far as services that you all provide?
Also, you know, we work with a lot of what I call benefit organizations to do event planning and event management.
Okay.
As well.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, thank you, ladies, so much for coming
on
the show.
Thank you for having us. We appreciate it.
I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Congratulations on your
anniversary.
Thank
you so much. Thank you so much. Well, I hope you guys learned a lot tonight about domestic violence and even some of the human trafficking, you could definitely go to the hotline, and they have different hotlines if you want to report it.
Absolutely.
as well as just to learn more about it. But our next wonderful guest is Miss Stacy Covington-Lee is going to be joining us, our author, and I'm excited about that. Mm-hmm. So after these messages, we'll have her on next.
Hey, this is Johnny Van Zandt. You're watching American Hearts Radio Web TV.
Have with us Miss Stacy Covington-Lee, and thank you so much, Stacy, for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Yes.
I appreciate you having
Stacy
me.
Stacy came to our conference last month, and mm-hmm. we got to meet for the first time.
Yes.
And definitely, I told her, I was like, we have to have you on the show in April, Stacy, because we're going to be focusing on domestic violence mm-hmm. and sex trafficking, and some of the books that you've written is kind of has some emphasis in there, you know, so we want to talk a little bit about that. But tell us, what inspired you to become an author?
Well, I've always loved writing. I eat books. I read constantly. And I've always loved writing. Mm-hmm. I read a book. I always attribute Judy Blume. I read a book when I was a preteen.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret. And I read the book, and I thought to myself, I can do that. Mm-hmm. I want to do that. Uh-huh. You know, I can write a story.
Wow.
But I started writing back then. I was, you know, around 12, 11, 12 years old. And after working, one of my best friends, she knew of this passion I had for writing, for literature.
Mm-hmm.
And she came to me one day, and I know this was just her very gentle nudge. And she was like, you know, we should write a book together because we just finished a novel by two best friends. And she goes, we should write a book together. And mm-hmm. I was like, okay. So she comes over, and we sit in my office, and mm-hmm. I'm at the computer, and I start typing. And with the first chapter, every idea she had, I would say, you know, that's good. But maybe by the end of the first chapter, she was like, all right, honey, you're on your way. This is your
you
baby.
You don't need my help.
You don't need me. And of that process, my first novel, The Knife in My Back, was born.
Wow. Mm-hmm. And so The Knife in My Back, actually, Stacy wrote four books,
yes.
But The Knife in My Back is a two-part series.
Yes.
So can you give us a little insight on that?
The Knife in My Back is a story of friendship and betrayal. Unfortunately, it is a story that many young women, that many women regardless of age, mm-hmm. know about. And mm-hmm. it's the story of two women that become friends.
Mm-hmm.
One is from a privileged background. She has a, you know, what one might call a charmed life.
Mm-hmm.
And the other grew up on the wrong side of the track, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
And her name is Tamika.
Mm-hmm.
And Tamika is quite the user. She's very, very smart.
Mm-hmm.
But she would rather just, she thinks the world owes her something.
Mm-hmm.
And so she would rather take from her friend than to earn whatever she wants for herself.
She needs to practice some civility.
She needs to practice some civility, yes. And, but when she takes that one thing that mm. means the most to her friend, and of course people always go, oh, it was her man.
Mm.
And I always say women have so many issues that are so far beyond a man.
Now you're telling your business.
Yeah. It's like, you know, no.
A man. Read the book.
Read the book. When she takes that one thing that means the most to Brooke, the more privileged friend,
mm-hmm.
Brooke pays her back in a very unusual way.
Mm.
And part two is about redemption.
Wow.
She's given it. Tamika has an opportunity to change her life, to redeem herself, to be a better woman.
Mm.
And does she take that opportunity, mm-hmm. or is it just too easy for her to backslide?
Mm-hmm. You gotta read the book.
Gotta read the book.
Wow, wonderful. Okay, so then the third book.
Then the third book is Bitter Taste of Love.
Okay.
And we've all seen those couples, you know, you see the man and the woman and they look so beautiful and you go, mm-hmm. oh, they just like to have the perfect life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have these two beautiful, well-behaved kids and, mm-hmm. you know, well, that is what Bitter Taste of Love is. It gives us a sneak peek behind the closed doors of what's perceived to be a perfect marriage, where the husband is very verbally abusive, he's mm-hmm. a cheat, he's a philanderer, and the wife, just being lost, she goes about things the wrong way and seeks a little love and happiness outside of her marriage.
Mm.
Well, when the husband finds out, when the truth unfolds, there's just a huge explosion. And in there, she's with friends that have betrayed her as well. Mm. She's having to deal with the consequences of her actions. Mm-hmm. And it's a very fast-paced book, mm-hmm. but it's important to me that even though I write for entertainment purposes, mm-hmm. that my book have a point. They teach mm-hmm. a lesson, yes. you know? Mm-hmm. And so watching her deal with the fallout from that, and another aspect of Bitter Taste of Love is mm-hmm. that main character, Cecily, mm-hmm. not only is she dealing with her marriage, the fallout of the affair, but she is also a sickle cell disease patient.
Wow.
And so sickle cell has plays a big role in that book, mm-hmm. and that's just important to me because, again, I like to entertain, but I like for my writing to have a purpose, and I think authors can write to entertain but also to educate. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I'm trying to set about
yes.
doing now.
Yeah. So speaking of sickle cell, yes. we talked a little bit about that. So you want to share your story with us?
Well, the funny thing, people always ask me, if there's one thing in your book that's true, or in any of your books that's true about yourself, mm-hmm. what is it? Mm-hmm. Well, in Bitter Taste of Love, the thing that's true is that, like Cecily, I am a sickle cell disease patient. Mm-hmm. And like the character in the book, people think, you know, and of course, it is a blood disease that affects the African-American community. Mm-hmm. And people always think, you know, oh, well, you were born with it, so you would know about it, mm-hmm. you know, immediately at birth.
Yes.
That's not necessarily
yeah,
so.
Exactly.
I have two sisters, an older sister. As soon as she was born, she was suffering as a baby, you know, on through her adulthood. Mm-hmm. My younger sister, it was discovered when she was 5 and had a really bad sickle cell crisis.
Okay.
And so she has since been dealing, and the thing is, sickle cell affects everyone so differently.
Mm-hmm.
Me, everyone thought I was fine.
Mm-hmm.
They thought I was fine until I was 21 and
wow.
I moved away from home and got in a very, very stressful situation, and the stress is what triggered my sickle cell, and I ended up in the hospital out of state.
Wow.
No family, no one around me.
Goodness.
And I ended up, and it was a hematologist there that told me, you know, you have sickle cell. I was like, no, I don't. I have the trait. My sisters have sickle cell. I don't have sickle cell.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, no, you have sickle cell.
Yeah.
And so that was a pivotal moment for me because it has now become where it was something that I didn't give a second thought as far as my own health.
Mm-hmm.
It is something that I deal with every day now.
Yes, yes,
so.
Yes. But that hasn't influenced your writing.
Absolutely not.
So book number 4.
Book number 4.
Which I'm excited about
yes,
because it just came out.
It's actually been out a few months now.
Uh-huh.
But I'm still very excited about it.
Yes.
And it is Hate the Way He Loves Me.
All right. Let's show viewers what it looks like.
Hate the Way He Loves Me. And the funny thing is that how I was just telling you that very stressful situation
yes.
that triggered my sickle cell to become active
mm-hmm.
Ties in with this book.
Mm-hmm.
Hate the Way He Loves Me is a story of domestic violence.
Mm-hmm.
You have a family, 2 sisters and their mother, and these 3 women suffered horrible abuse at the hands of the husband, father, a man named Otis.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have Martha, who's the mother, Zoe, she's the baby sister, Pam is the older girl.
Mm-hmm.
And this book shows you, briefly gives you a preview, or it briefly takes you into their background to show you, you know, what they're trying to come out of,
mm-hmm.
how they're trying to move forward in their life.
Mm-hmm.
It is the strength of Zoe, the baby girl, that gets them out of the domestic violence situation
mm-hmm.
with her father.
Wow.
It is, and because of the strength she showed to rescue them, so
mm-hmm.
to speak, from that. The family looks to her and they depend on her. She's their pillar of strength. When it looks like the father, Otis, may be coming back around,
mm-hmm.
they run to her, you know,
yeah.
and she uproots the family and moves them down south.
Wow.
Where they are living happy lives and everything seems to be, you know, going so well.
Mm-hmm.
And so well to the point where Zoe, who has denied herself a love relationship all this time, now decides, you know what, maybe I will give love a try. I'm lonely. Maybe I will. And, of course, we know we always revert back to what we know. People gravitate towards what they know. Yeah. And the gentleman she falls in love with is an abuser.
And she doesn't know it.
And she doesn't know it, but she soon finds out.
Okay, so if they want to order your books, where can they go? What is your website?
My website is www.stacycovingtonlee.com. The books can be found on my website as well as Amazon.com, BarnesandNoble.com, Kobo.com. Yes. They're also on Google Play and iTunes.
Yes, and you can read a little excerpt of the book as well, because I started reading it and I was like, oh, I can't wait to finish the book. So you definitely, if you start reading the excerpt, you're going to want to order the book.
Yes,
definitely.
You can find full chapter excerpts of all of my books on my website.
Yes. Well, thank you so much for coming out.
Thank you, Stacy, for having me. Happy anniversary.
Thank you. Thank you. We're going to definitely have you back. And I hope you enjoyed the tea.
Thank you. Yes.
Everybody enjoyed our tea. So we had our tea time. But thank you guys for tuning in tonight and our anniversary special. And I definitely hope you'll go and check out everything on our YouTube channel. You can go to youtube.com. Remarkable Essence. For those of you that want to pass on this information, this was an awesome show. And thank you for sharing even your story as well, because
thank
I know
you.
A lot of people out there just wonder. I mean, everybody has a journey, but all of our journeys are different. But
Absolutely.
We're still going to fulfill the purpose that God has for us.
Absolutely.
And that's how you're doing it, through your writing.
Oh, thank you.
So thank you. And we'll see you guys next time. Bye.